I'm Costa, or Costandi. I'm a local musician and music teacher in the area. I work with some choirs, I work at a church, and I do some stuff with some schools in the area. Today I'm going to be going ahead and talking about a topic that's going to seem difficult to comprehend the title of at first, but I'm going to try to get you guys through it. So basically this, I'm going to be talking about compositional techniques. Oh, this is small. Techniques throughout the centuries. And specifically, I'm going to be looking at three piano repertoire pieces. Or three piano solos. Before I get into talking about those piano solos, I want to start talking about some definitions. And I'm going to start at a very basic level because I think it'll highlight the usefulness of this topic. But I want to start with, what is music? I want us to think about that for just a few seconds. So what do we mean when we call something music? Yeah?
Form of notes in a measure.
Form of notes in a measure. So when we say notes, what's a note?
Something that makes sound.
So notes is a sound, yeah? So we have sounds, and then what's a measure?
Like the amount of sounds in a second.
So seconds is time. So music has something to do with sounds and time, right? For sure. So if you ask me, I would say that music is sound organized over time. Right? I think that's a pretty fair definition, and that's what I'm going to be working with. So when we have a piece of music or song, so when I'm talking about piano, we're really using the word piece more so, but what's a piece of music?
Just like a diagram or just sheet music, like a piece, like a physical piece of paper you're talking about, or like
like the auditory experience of a piece of music, right? So we can think of it as a song or a piece of music, but either way, it's a single unit of music that's supposed to be continuous with itself, right? Some continuous amount of organized sound. O-U-S. So if we decide that a piece of music is a continuous amount of organized sound, what makes it continuous? We need something to hold it together, right? And I think one of the fundamental things that we use to hold it together is some amount of reused or modified materials. So in order to keep unity, we need reused or modified material. So if we're looking at pop songs, that might be like a chorus or a verse that like has the same notes to it. We're going to be looking at classical piano pieces today, and we're going to talk about how composers have throughout the centuries to use material that comes in either the beginning of the piece or other places and reused it later in a piece. And we'll talk about the different ways that they've done so, okay? So we're going to start off with a type of piece that's called a piano etude by a guy named Bergmuller. Bergmuller's not a particularly famous composer. He's from the late 19th century, roughly, and is mostly known as a piano teacher. So when I say etude, that just means study or something that's meant to improve your technique at something. However, these etudes still have the sense of being pieces that could be performed. I'm going to go ahead and start by performing it. I'm just going to leave this to the side. So this is La Cloche du Matin, or The Morning Bell. And you're going to hear why it's called The Morning Bell in a second, I'm sure.
Thank you.
So La Cloche du Matin. First, I'm gonna ask: does anyone know why it was called the Matin Bell or the Morning Bell? Yeah, that thing over and over again. So that's like the bell ringing and ringing over and over again, like a church bell or something being rung in the morning. So what I wanted to talk about is different ways that La Cloche du Matinée or Morning Bell. Okay, I'm gonna just go ahead and rip this one off. Okay. We'll put it here. I wanna talk about the ways that La Cloche du Matinée or the Morning Bell reuses material. And the first way is gonna be the most obvious way, and that is just straight unmodified reuse. In the case of that piece, you can hear it pretty consistently with that opening section, right? So we go through it, we get towards the ending of that section, which sounds something more like, what is it? And then after the second time, it's a little different. It's a, yeah. So the two different times that we have it, the only difference is that ending little bit. We get on to what I'm going to call our B section. So that unmodified reuse is we have A and we play it two times, and we have a B section. I'm gonna leave the B section alone for a little bit. After the B section, we have what I'm going to call a transition. That's okay. And then we end up ending with a restatement of A. This restatement of A is a little different, right? So I'm gonna go ahead and replay it for a second. So whereas the other ones have a shorter thing before it goes back in on itself or moves on to B, this last iteration of it, the ending is longer, right? So as a result, I'm going to say that this version is an extension. So we reuse materials, but we add something extra to the end of it and we'll call it an extension, okay? That's one way the composers can reuse material. And then finally, we're gonna look at this B section. The B section, the way it reuses materials in on itself is a little more abstract. So first, we can compare it to the A section, which I'm just gonna go ahead and play the left hand alone. We have that sort of pattern going on, whereas with the A section with the right hand, we have. So either way, we have this kind of chordy thing going on with a repeated chord figure. So we have the timbral unifying way by reusing the timbral effect of that earlier section. The other form of reused material is, I'm gonna go ahead and play through that whole section quickly with both hands. Yeah. Okay, I'm gonna have to redo that. Okay, I'm just gonna take this off. Okay, because it's, oh, okay, my goodness. Sorry. So if you can hear, we have bum, 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 bum. And we have that same kind of little motivic bit going on over and over again. We can hear it again over here. So over and over again, we have this little falling pattern. So in that sense, we can unify a single section by reusing smaller melodic chunks. Reuses small melodic chunks as well as, what was the other thing? Timbral or accompaniment figures from earlier parts. From earlier section. So all of that does a lot to create a sense of unity in Bergmuller's Morning Bell or Matin Bell. So that is kind of in the late Romantic era. Now we're gonna go ahead and rewind 100 years to our next piece. I'm gonna go ahead and move this one along. Thank you. The next one we're going to be talking about is Solfeggio in C minor by Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach. The name Bach might sound familiar, but you probably would think of Johann Sebastian Bach first, who is actually Carl Philipp Emanuel's father. So we're listening to something by Bach's son, essentially. Although in his time, he was more famous than his dad. But you know, things change over the era, the years. So it's today's well-known Bach's son, who back a few hundred years ago was more famous than his dad. So a little reversal happened at some point. Although he always thought his dad was better than he was, so, you know, whatever, it's fine. Okay, so again, this is Solfeggio in C minor. So that's that piece. It's pretty fast, pretty short, but there's a lot of musical material in it in a relatively short amount of time. So breaking it down, another thing I wanted to talk about, and it's going to be more important for this one, is we have something called scales in music. So a scale is just that, essentially. So it's a sequence of notes that all go together. And a scale is kind of the biggest part of our harmony. We're always in a scale, usually. A scale has something called scale degrees in it. And the scale degrees are the individual notes in the scale. So that's, this would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then 1 again. So we only have 7 of them. The ones that I'm gonna be talking about most are 1. And by the way, we use this little hat, basically, to say that we're talking about scale degrees. Kind of in order of importance, I'm going to also talk about 5, 4, 3 as well for this piece in particular. 7 is generally more interesting than 5, 4, or 3, but I'm not really going to be talking about this time. So 7 is just a leading tone. Like if I were to end on 7, you'd really feel it. Yeah, because it leads to 1 really strongly, essentially. So that's kind of the power of 7, but I'm not going to be talking about it as much here. 1, 5, and 4, and 3 all have special names. 1 is the tonic, that's like home. 5 is the dominant. So 5 is kind of like our center of away, if that makes sense. Its technical name is subdominant, we don't need to use it today. 4 is subdominant, sorry, 5 is dominant, 4 is subdominant. So the reason why it's called subdominant is because it leads well into 5. And then we have 3, which is called the mediant, and it's just called the mediant because it's a third away from 1. The function of 3, we're really not going to be using as much, but still, it's going to be useful to know that Three appears a lot in some pretty key spots in this piece. And that's gonna help us understand how he shifts around with this. So we have our kind of main melody, which is gonna be this thing. That whole thing. And it appears three other times in the piece. So we have main melody, I'm gonna call it. Oh, sorry. And it starts in C minor. That little M stands for minor. And minor is the sad sounding scale, basically. So the next time we hear it, it sounds like this. So it's actually kind of sounds pretty similar, right? But it's a little lower. And actually, it's changed scale that's in. And it's gone from being in our home to our away or five, the dominant. So we move from C minor to G minor. It's a little interesting that it's in minor, but we don't need to talk about more than that. And then our next spot, after we do some more transitory material, so we have like main melody, and then we have like an other thing in C minor, and then we have main melody and other in G minor, and then finally we have main melody plus other in F minor. So we do it all three in three different keys, and we have a little other section in each one. I'm just gonna call it an other because it's just a different type of material that's used. I'm going to be talking more about the G minor for a little bit because then we have a little transition back. And then we end with C minor again, which I'm not gonna play the whole thing in another section, but that's fine. So what technique is he using? He's using the same material, he's reusing it, but he's changing the scale that he's in this time. And it's also interesting to see the way that he shifts from one scale to another scale, because actually every time you hear this, that whole thing, or every time, the transitional thing will end with a single note on our third scale degree, that median scale degree. So I'm gonna go ahead and play from the beginning, and I'm going to stop once I hit the median for the next section. So that note right there, that's our median for going to G minor. So if I played it from there, you'd hear the same thing. But instead he just goes. So, like I said, we hit that G minor section. I'm gonna skip a little bit into the transitory part of G, and I'm gonna do the same thing once we get to that median note for F, just to highlight it. Yeah, there we are. And then he goes through that the same way. Then we have a transition that goes back to C minor. And what's interesting about this transition section is that it's a different type of material reuse. So I'm gonna play the G minor one, and then I'm gonna talk about the transition back. So, oh, sorry, the G minor ones. Now I'm gonna play through the F minor section to show you. That same thing, but this time, like in the Bergmuller, we have an extension. So he reuses the other part of the G major, but extends it this time. So he took a fraction of that G major B section, essentially, and extended it. So the extended version is. And like all the other times, we end on that median note, heading back to C minor. And then how does he end it? So we had a lot of scalar materials in it. And at the very ending, all he does to end it is. is a little fraction going backwards and descending. So that's a little bit of how C.P. Bach uses reuses material. We're going to go ahead and now talk about something a lot more recent. So we're going to go, oh, I ripped off two of them. My bad. Okay. I'm going to rig myself up. I'm going to take a small pause in between the pages just to make life easier for me. So this is Shooting Stars in Summer. We are going, I would say 250 years in the future from that, because this is from 2007. It's by a Japanese composer, a lady named Naoko Ikeda. Sorry, I'm gonna go ahead and change the page now. I'm just making it as easy as possible for myself. I kind of redo that. Sorry about that. I wasn't looking at the page. I'm going to go back a little bit. I'm going to go from there. Sorry about that. Maybe not my best performance, but we're gonna go ahead and talk about it anyway. So this piece also, I'm gonna go ahead and divide into sections a little bit. Ba 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 bum. So we have our beginning section, which I'll just call A. And it's about the first 8 measures. And then we have that little break. And after the 2 breaks, we eventually get into this sort of kind of main themey thing. So we'll call it A/intro. B, which kind of feels to me like almost a main theme. And then we have what I'm gonna call B prime. The prime just means it's slightly different. C, and then we're gonna end with kind of an A prime section, kind of. So, the thing about this is when I say prime, I'm using it really loosely because she changes the material quite a bit. But if you listen to the underpinning harmony, you can hear that it's effectively, functionally the same thing. So first let's compare A and A prime for a second. Oh, geez. Okay. Just that much, okay? Now let's listen to, kind of towards the end of the piece, that measure 30 spot. So you can hear that effectively what my left hand is playing is exactly the same. It's just that the melody or right hand has changed. So what she's doing here is the harmony is unifying. Even if the melody is changed. We can find that same thing with B, that sort of B section, which I'm gonna have to switch back to here. Oh, my goodness. A little heavy. Okay, I'm gonna put this over here just for stability's sake. And I'm gonna look on it. So here is the left hand for B. Da-da-da-da-da. And we have that occurs in a few spots. So that's more different, but then we kind of get back into the main part of it, where again, we have a slightly different melody going on. So the melody the first time, let's see if we can spot the difference a little bit. Da-da-da-da-da. Just that much, versus the second time around, it sounds like this. Oh, sorry, wrong hand. So actually, the interesting part of this is that the first two measures totally the same. And then the next section is a little. And then this is very ornamented compared to the first time, and it's moving in the opposite direction. But then we end still with this note versus the first time, which you can hear. Ending with the same note. So we reached the same spot, but she's modified the melody and transformed it in a different manner. So ways that we can modify the melody, ornamentation. And that same sort of ornamentation happens when the A section comes back. So these are unified harmonically, but with an ornamented melody, and this one is unified, again, harmonically, with, again, a slightly more ornate melody. Yep. Yeah, basically. So when I say ornament, it's like, I could play. Or I could do. Something like that, you know, where I've added more notes, but the contour stays the same. So the idea is kind of if you've ever listened to a good example of ornamentation in music is like when you hear people sing the national anthem and they kind of have these added sections or notes and some riffs. Yeah. That's essentially what I'm talking about when I say ornamentation. So she does that a little bit here where she adds some ornamentation on repeat sections. But yeah, so this last one is a good example of how a composer can reuse melody. And the other thing that I think is pretty stable is that you hear a pretty similar hand technique in the left hand the whole way through, where it's pretty like mellow rising chords. But yeah. So that's the three of them. I think that's a pretty good explanation of them. Any questions?
How long have you been playing piano?
I started in high school, so it's probably been a decade now. But I would say you can get to where I am in less than a decade. I wasn't practicing for a while, and yeah.
This was like the first, was the first or second? I mean, you just
that one?
You just fly through it.
Yeah.
And that, so that's you kind of just accelerating it to explain, but if you were playing with feeling, it would be slowed down, yeah?
Oh, this one? Oh no, it's supposed to be fast.
Oh, it is?
It's a label for tempo is prestissimo, which means as fast as possible.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my god.
These other ones are just slower pieces. The hardest part of any of the pieces actually is this last piece. When I'm doing that and I'm doing this at the same time. So because the challenge with that actually is that this hand is doing three da 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 da, and this one's doing duples or bum 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 bum. So I have to do that at the same time, and it's more challenging. Yeah, essentially.
As far as kids from Wisconsin, are you an educator there, or do you also
yes.
participate in the performances?
I'm primarily an educator there. Right now, I work with some disabled adults with a partnership with Pink Umbrella.
Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome. And then, so if people wanted to learn some, and you mainly teach piano?
I mainly teach voice. I'm a classical singer.
Oh, okay. That's right. But okay. As part of, I guess, when you're a vocalist, you have to know some instrumentation.
Yeah. So, like, if I'm teaching a piano or a voice lesson, for example, I have to kind of be able to do... It has to be easy enough where I don't have to look at it. And I'm mostly thinking about, what's the person in front of me doing? What are they doing here and here? Okay, are they doing that well enough? And then while I'm doing that. So to an extent, it's really valuable to have good piano skills. And then also, potentially, if you're good enough, you can also like accompany them and also pay attention to what they're doing while you're playing the piano for them.
Yeah. So have you been doing voice longer than piano then?
Yeah, I've done probably more like 15.
Okay. Well, you're a freaking professional. Thank you for giving us a